What's up, guys, and welcome to Fab with Matt. It feels like it's been some time.
It has. It's only been like a month, right?
Yeah.
I think just a lot's happened in that time, right?
A lot's happened to you. Thank you guys for joining us. Obviously, this week we are going to be talking about Monarch Limited, specifically Draft. Matt has an awesome breakdown. We're going to go through some packs, lay out some picks.
Well, it might be an awesome breakdown. We don't really know. Who knows? Like, we're going to open some packs and we're going to talk about them.
Well, you know, the breakdown's on you. So
okay. So you're putting the pressure on, eh?
Yeah, so hopefully that's you. We know LSS have put together a good product. So yeah, I'm assuming the packs will deliver, and now all the pressure's on your shoulders.
Fair enough.
For the breakdown.
I like a bit of pressure.
Yeah. So just that's for later on, but we'll be touching on some of Matt's thoughts on Monarch, the draft format. But we have obviously something big to touch on and talk about before that happens.
Is it the fact that we're not on the couches anymore?
That is something. You guys will have noticed.
We've just recently moved offices, so we've just moved into the new offices.
I would call it moving. The Fab with Matt couches will be back.
We're going to lift them up the stairs eventually. Yeah. We're just not quite up to it yet.
We're a bit
worn out from all the moving, I think. So logging couches up those stairs, it's like...
Yeah, I felt like something with a little more back support.
This is kind of nice, isn't it, after a long day of moving?
Yeah. But we're super excited. Obviously, this new space just means bigger, better things. Hopefully, we'll be able to record a ton more videos. You'll definitely be getting the monthly video as per normal, but we'll see what's in the works coming up.
Yeah. Fab's maybe do some gameplay and stuff in the boardroom.
Maybe. Fab's ramping up. So it probably only makes sense that Fab with Matt ramps up as well.
Yeah, fair enough.
But the big thing I wanted to touch on before we get into the breakdown of Monarch, obviously... you finally did it. You got over the
hump. I've gone and done it.
You won a lot of other things, but calling champion. So the calling Auckland 2021 champion, Matt Rogers, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
Thanks, man.
It was an awesome event. Before we touch on how you did and the event, I did play the event as well. Matt will know. I like to think of myself as the first stepping stone to his victory. For you guys that don't know, we actually matched up in the first round of the tournament.
Yeah, round one of the tournament. Periods go up. Aaron versus Matt.
Yes.
And I'm like, oh, I guess it's an easy start to the day.
Yeah. And at the event to just, you know, get me through. Obviously, I lost. The man won the event. He kicked me to the curb in round one. I like to tell myself that it was close, but it was close in one of those Fab ways where even though the life totals were kind of close, we both knew where it was kind of going early. But yeah, before we talk about that anyway, I don't want to say the event was awesome.
The event was fantastic. It was well run. There was vibe, and it was all weekend. It wasn't just one day. There was so much going on. Yeah.
Shout out to LSS. Well. James, Jason, Chris, Sasha unfortunately couldn't be there. He was ill for the weekend. But there was another Chris. There was a Callum. There was
Kieran.
The whole office. I feel like I'm missing somebody.
Jacob Newson.
Alan.
There's so many now.
Yeah, there's so many.
They started as such a small company, and then like 2 years later, they're massive.
But they were all there, all putting in the work. It was amazing. The venue was amazing. As soon as you walked in, you could tell that they really meant business.
Yeah.
Like that this was going to be an awesome event. They had vendors there, obviously Card Merchant.
Yeah, Card Merchant had a showing.
And they even had some artists coming and doing some signings throughout the day.
It was really, really good. It was a proper, I've been to a lot of Magic Grand Prix and Pro Tours and stuff over the years, and it's always fun, it's always good, there's always a lot going on and stuff, but like LSS really do these to like a premium level. There's just something a little bit more sharp
about, well, I think specifically about this event was like 3 or 4 notches up.
Yeah.
To me.
Yeah.
Like just they always knew what the vision was for these events.
Yeah.
Obviously they were a new company, they're gonna go and they did really well with the time, but it really felt like they cranked the dial up for this event.
Yeah,
it was.
It felt like I was in a place that they might set up for, like, I don't know, some big esports $1 million tournament or something, you know, like there was these massive screens, like all of the tables and chairs and stuff. They hadn't cheaped out on anything, even though they were setting up a venue for, you know, 250 players or whatever. Everything was like, you know, all of the furniture was like high class, nice furniture that they hired. They put these massive projectors up that, you know, all of the banners and these huge big walls of things. The streaming area was
the streaming was great. We have to talk about that.
The whole LSS, area was amazing.
LSS, listen to us. Come in close.
All right.
Come in close.
Come for a chat.
James, I know you're watching this video.
He's really not. He's
not. Okay, who am I talking to? Alan, Jason, what are you guys?
Somebody that'll tell James.
Please, we need more streams.
Yeah.
We need more streams. The commentary, everything was really, really great.
Yeah, I spent hours watching the stream after the event, after I'd already known what happened.
This guy watching himself on stream.
I didn't watch my games as much. I definitely watched my finals.
Yeah.
I mean, to be honest, I do generally go back and watch my games as well. Just I think it's good to, as a player, like just, you know, kind of identifying, you know, points where you gave away a little bit more than you should have, or whether
No, I'm just taking notes for when I eventually make it on camera. I remember to rewatch this over.
There's been some stream games of mine that I've watched that have kind of blown my mind, to be honest. Being like,
in a bad way or in a good way?
Well, I guess a bit of both, but being like, man, I could have actually pivoted at this point and like it would have changed the whole outcome of the game. You know, and that's what's cool about Fab is small decisions make massive differences, and you can kind of sort of watch the cards that are played and pitched in graveyard and kind of work out how the game would have developed, you know, along the different lines.
Yeah, so
and
true.
And you know, sometimes I go through it with my testing partner Nick, and we kind of, you know, we try to really deeply dive into the points of the game and kind of write things down and kind of figure out how the games would have played out with small little changes. And sometimes how they would have played out is massively different.
Yeah.
You know, like massive.
I remember looking over, I think it was the finals of the Mighty Ape event where you were playing Jacob in the finals in the Ira mirror.
Yeah.
And we obviously looked at that and you're able to dissect, like, oh, of course, this is the only card he could have had here because he played this, and I should have blocked with my tunic at the beginning of the chain rather than the middle, and all this sort of different things. And so it is good, like you said, to have that sort of video record. If you are on camera or if you're on a streamed event, it's obviously great.
To be honest, even if you're just testing at home or doing a draft at a store or something, get a camera behind you, record the games, you know. If you're testing with some mates, record a testing session, go through it later. If you're drafting at a store or wherever, if you can set up a little, you know, tripod on a desk behind you and just record your draft.
Yeah.
You know, I got Nick Butcher to do that as well. And we went through his draft. We went through one of his drafts before the call-in and sort of, kind of dissected all of the things and the signals that he was getting and what, you know, got really, really deep into it. So yeah. I think
I've seen a few people doing it. I think Ian, for one, you would have seen him on stream doing some of the commentary for the event, Right Time Gaming, I believe it is, if you check that out on Facebook. But he often is popping up the tripod, recording his draft picks, able to go back over it later and double check. And it's just good.
It's a great attitude for improvement. I think information's key, right?
Yeah. Top 8 of the calling. I don't know if they're going to be let you pop out your own tripod.
No. Maybe not top 8 of the calling.
But your local LGS.
Yeah. I mean, they recorded some of the drafts, I think, from the top 8, some of the drafters. So I think they're going to make some content out of that and put it up, I guess. I'm not sure. Or maybe it was just for their own research purposes. I'm not 100% sure, but they did have some cameras that were hooked up and, you know, watching people draft.
Yeah.
So
obviously we know you won the event, but the calling day one, Well, yeah, so day one was mixed format, actually, the way it ended.
Yeah, it was six rounds of sealed and then one draft.
One draft.
Yeah,
and
three
day
rounds
two,
of draft.
Another draft and thing. But
and then
yeah,
top eight, yeah.
How'd the seal go?
Yeah. I mean, it went really well. I can't ask for better. I went 6-0 and sealed. I went undefeated. At the start of the day, I opened my deck and it was nothing exceptional. I'd like exceptional. I'd love to open a pool with 2 V of the Vanguards and all of the everythings and, you know, or a bunch of Red Heralds or a 40 card chain deck or, you know, whatever. I don't know. I'd love to open great things, but you can't expect that. You know, going into sealed, those things are great, but it's not always going to happen. But I opened my sealed pool. It wasn't fantastic, but I had all the tools to play the exact game that I like to play. So my deck was great.
So a little damage here, draw you into the late game.
Yeah, mid-range knit. that's how I like to play. Yeah. So basically I had a lot of block threes. I had some good 6-power generics so that I wouldn't get, you know, so that the other prison players wouldn't just walk all over me.
Well, I think that was like when I had a look through your deck was a point that was really good. Obviously you're a prison, but the how many of the red I'm blanking on
Red Rally the Rearguard. Yeah, so I had three of those. I had a foil and two regulars. So that was the most important thing.
Yeah.
Is I had three Rally the Rearguards, which A, meant that Prism couldn't just walk all over me, and B, meant my deck could block really, really well because I'm playing like a bunch of three blocks, and then my two blocks like Rally can turn my other two blocks into three blocks effectively by block, discard a card. So my deck was very good at being able to kind of pick its points of what it wants to do, block when it wants to block, and then kind of turn the tide over if I make a spectral shield token and then start attacking. But yeah, exactly the way I want to play in the sealed format, I think. Knit around.
Yeah.
And be able to chop and change based on what my opponent's doing, figure out if I want to fatigue them, if I want to, you know, kind of wear out all of their big red cards. You know, if they're already pitching blues and stuff, I just block in the early game, wait until they're going to be redrawing those blues and not be doing powerful things, and that's when I'll be attacking them back. It just gives me so many options when I have a deck like that. So that's really what I was going into the call and hoping to get to sealed.
Yeah. Well, I think there's, we talked about it a little bit before, but like there's a lot of talk about Prism and Sealed being the go-to. You can have that sort of mid-range, like it takes maybe a little less synergy and whatnot to get it going and get it to a right place.
Well, I think it's more that Prism has, all of the cards are decent, you know? It doesn't really have too many bad cards.
They do
lots of it mediocre cards and lots of decent cards. So it's very easy if your seal pool isn't great, you can usually play a Prism deck. So the way this format seems to be very much built towards draft, a lot of the sealed pools are not great. So generally, a lot of the time, people just play Prism because it's something that they can get together.
Well, the other strategies
Bolton needs a lot more synergy.
Yeah.
Chain needs a lot more synergy. And even Brute needs a lot more synergy. Otherwise, they're just going to block you, wait till you've got some blood debts, and then keep blocking you until you die to your own blood debts, you know? Yeah. So, the other classes all need synergy, and Prism just really doesn't.
Yeah. Well, I mean, that's basically where my sealed ended up. I opened it. It was a 5 out of 10, I'd say, it's a seal pool. But it was pretty evenly spread across all the classes.
That's actually what you don't want.
Yeah. And I was kind of put in a spot where I think it was between Broomblade and Bolton. I had the one V of the Vanguard and one Soul Reaping, but on either side I had no Take Flights and no Seeds.
That does not sound like a good spot to be.
Not
in,
enough
man.
6 powers play limit. There was some other stuff, but obviously none of that key stuff that's really bringing the synergy like you're talking about, right? It was a stock average.
It sounds like I would have just played Prism.
I had no red Phantasms.
Oh, well then you have to play a different style of Prism.
It was tough, but I ultimately decided to play Bolton, as you know, who faced off in the first round, basically leaning towards Bolton over Chain, simply because if I'm leaning more heavily on one or two cards to try and win the game with Bolton, I know I can work myself in a position where I am going to see them. Whereas with Chain, the nature of the deck, like if my Soul Reaping flips off the top or my other red attack, like it becomes a lot more difficult. So we grinded away.
Yeah.
We tried to grind away.
Ended what, 4-2? Positive record.
I lost a I lost to you in the first round, four in a row, and then had a really tight match against Rohan Khanna.
Oh, you lost in your final round. Oh, you would have been very close to top 32, right?
Yeah, I think I want to say like 37, 36 or something like that. Rohan, you guys will know, I think he's currently undefeated in the
charity event.
In the charity event.
He's crushing.
Obviously a great, great, great player. But yeah, it was a grand fest. It's sealed. You know, it happens.
Yeah.
I had a great time regardless, which is...
I mean, by the time this video is up, the charity event would have been finished. So he might not be undefeated in the charity event, but he was undefeated in the Swiss.
He was undefeated in the Swiss, which is...
I think 8-0, right? 8-0 in the Swiss. Yeah.
Yeah. So,
but yeah, so that's sealed.
And then
draft, we probably don't. I mean, we're about to do a whole segment on, so you know, we don't have to talk a massive amount on draft because we're about to. You know, what we're going to do after this is we're going to open some packs in front of the camera, right? We're gonna. I mean, you've figured out exactly what we're going to do. You're the brains behind this.
Yeah. So I think you're going to work through what. Three people's picks.
Yeah.
Right? So there's going to
be... So I'm three seats at the table.
You'll see...
Matt.
Yeah. You'll see, and then you're going to pass that same pack down two seats and take what you would think you would take
in
that pack turned up. Obviously, the person to your left, you're not going to see their first pick, and the person to your right, sorry, you're not going to see their first pick, and then two over again, not the first two, but that's so early on, I don't really think that's going to affect it too much, right? You're going to base it more off what you're going to see anyway, and I'm going to do my best to pass you more packs as it would come, and we'll be able to see what I first, second, and third pick on a couple as well at the end.
Okay.
But, yeah, it'll be good.
Okay, cool. Well, I mean, I'll try to talk as, you know, about as much strategy and kind of what I would be thinking in that spot. You know, if this was top eight of the calling, you know, what sort of information I think is happening, what information I'm giving, you know, to the players on my right, what information I'm receiving from the players on my left, and how I want my seat to develop, I guess. So we'll see if we end up with kind of decent strategies, or if we
get a lot of
a train wreck situation.
Get a lot of the draft analysis in. Yeah. But awesome.
Yeah, let's get into it.
All right, let's
get into it. Okay, so as I said, I'm going to open this first pack. We're going to lay it out. We're going to talk about it, and we're going to take a pick from it. So we'll get rid of the token that's not needed. Get rid of the rubbish. All right, so this is what we have. This is what we're working with. All right, so... First thing that I'm going to want to do when I'm looking at a pack is put the shadowy cards together, the light cards together, and the generic cards by themselves. And then we're going to look for sort of standout power cards. Pick one, I'm not super focused on committing to anything. So I do like to kind of have a look at my more generic cards or my more generic, you know, kind of either shadow cards and light cards. Like that. So none of the generics stand out to me. Memorial Grounds is pretty garbage. Time Skippers is the worst equipment, I feel, and not something I'm looking to first pick. And then the Blue Belittle is all right. Blue Warmongers is all right, but neither of them are high pick standout cards. So I'm probably not going to be able to stay massively open this pick, but I'm also not going to commit to whatever I take anyway.
So here we're just going to kind of look at power at some of the more powerful cards that can somewhat stay open. Obviously, Void Wraith leaves me open to both the shadow classes more, so I'm not committing as much, but it's not amazing in Brute, and it's decent in Rune Blade, but also not a massive standout. And then Spew Shadow is more of a sideboard card, so it does, you know, it's not something I'm wanting a first pick because it's not going to make the cut a lot of the time. Invigorating Light Yellow is again just pretty mediocre. I like it. It's good. It keeps me open, but I'm also passing quite a lot of powerful light cards. So I'm not super keen on taking a mediocre light card and then passing the next few picks of people into power, you know, more powerful light cards. So this is a very interesting pick, to be honest. We're at a situation where we could take, you know, probably the better card in the pack is Take Flight. We could take Flight, but the issue with that is that somebody in the next like three odd picks is probably taking this Battlefield Blitz. So we're like taking a warrior card and passing a warrior card. I would usually take Flight here. I actually think the pick for me is going to be Riftbind. Now the main reason that I want to take Riftbind here is because if I take this shadow card out, I'm passing just a lot of light cards in this pack. So I think this Void Wraith might go at some point, but the rest of these cards are all low pick, and these light cards are all high pick. So I get to take a shadow card and set myself up potentially to be passing to light drafters. So what I'm going to do here, as I said, is I'm gonna be picking for three people. So after we take the first pick, we'll then look at the pack from a second pick perspective. Okay, so this has been taken. We don't know that. We're going into the second pick here, and this is the pack we see. So kind of one of the first things of note is that there's not many amazing shadow cards, and there's not very good generics as well. Same sort of thing we said. So if I'm looking to go shadow, it's Void Wraith, but I really don't want a second pick of Void Wraith. It's just not high enough on the power level. So I'd be looking at these light cards. So the highest considerations for me, I guess, are Invigorating Light if I want to stay open, but it's quite mediocre. Take Flight is a very good card. I definitely want as many of those as you can get if you're Warrior. Herald, again, a very good card. As many Herald of Protection as you can if you're Prism. And then Battlefield Blitz is pretty decent, but in the earlier things, I'd rather take things like Take Flight, and I'd more want to pick this up if I have a lot of charge and a lot of Take Flights and can kind of play the game that way. So my issue is if I take Herald, I know that the next person is probably going to take Flight. If I take Flight, the next person is probably going to take Herald, and the people after that are going to be between these two cards anyway. This might be next to go and then this, or it could be the other way around based on what they picked. So in terms of what I'm passing, I think ultimately I just want to take the more powerful card, and I think Take Flight is slightly better than Herald here. So as the second picker here, I'm going to take Flight. So that's this is drafter one, this is drafter two, and then this will be drafter three. So drafter three gets past this pack, and I think realistically the next best card in the pack is Herald. So drafter three is probably just going to take the Herald here. There's still a couple of Illusionist commons. It doesn't look like, because only commons have been taken so far, doesn't look like anybody's taken any Prism cards. So Prism seems reasonably open getting third pick this. So we're gonna take that here. And then I'm gonna hand this pack over to Aaron, who's gonna crack it and take one card out of it, so that then this gets to be their second pick, this gets to be third pick, and this gets to be fourth pick. So we don't know what these guys have taken first and second here. You know, the first pick for here and first and second pick for here. But this is just giving us kind of a general idea of how the draft goes around later on. So I'll pop those to the side. Cool. All right, let's have a look at this. So again, we're gonna bang our shadow stuff down here. We're gonna bang our light stuff over here. And I keep our generics up here. So, so interesting pack. We've got, in terms of good cards, we've got a lot more light than shadow, even though we actually have, you know, an extra shadow card than light. But in terms of the cards that make a big effect on the game, obviously Herald of Triumph is amazing. It's one of the better heralds because at seven, it hits often because it's very hard for them to blow it up. Then they need a 7+ power, so it's only really brute that blows it up often. So generally they're blocking with more than two cards to be able to stop it going into souls. So Red Herald of Triumph, very powerful card. Wartime Herald, again, it's a 7, so great herald for a common. It's not quite on the level of Wartime. And then Express Lightning, the red one is fantastic. Fantastic, because it allows you to set up quite well on a two card hand. So a good way to kind of get set up with Warrior in the earlier game is to be blocking with a couple of cards, and then with just two cards left, if you have Express Lightning, you don't need to pitch anything, you can just play this and charge. So you get kind of well set up there. Our generics are nothing flash. Blue Brandish is great, Blue Zealous is great, but they're blues, they're not high power level. I'm not looking to pick them early. And Ironhide Helm is the worst Ironhide, specifically because both the Shadow and Light classes have really good headpieces, which you generally want more than the Helm. So this is a lower pick equipment for me. So if I've first picked Riftbind, I'm not married to it. I'm looking towards Shadow, but not entirely. I'm just kind of considering what I want here. So I took the Riftbind. I passed a Take Flight and a red Shadow card, and then, you know, kind of a Herald and another Illusionist card and whatnot, and Battlefield Blitz. So I kind of assume that the next couple of people were light. So I do kind of want to pass the light cards and solidify them into light so that I can gain a fair bit of advantage from playing Shadow. So I want to lean towards Shadow. In a pack like this, I don't necessarily want to take an Express Lightning just after I've passed a Take Flight. It's not the end of the world. It's kind of fine to put them in Warrior. This is still early, so I could just take it. But what I like much more is passing a pack that has three very high pick light cards and taking a shadow card. So the next three people are all likely to take high pick light cards. It really sets myself up in a great spot. So Lunatide Plunderer Yellow is a great card. It's a 6 power for against Illusionist classes, and it goes into both shadow decks quite easily. So I quite like this here. I think it's definitely better than any of the generics. It's better than the shadow cards. I'm not going to commit to Runeblade straight away just because I picked one a Runeblade card. So I'm not looking to take a yellow Riftbind over this. You know, there's a chance I table this in a pack like this where there's some pretty powerful picks, but which would be great. But if not, I'm probably going to table either a Crack or a Rifted Torment. So I think either way, I'm fine. And this is a good high played card that's going to go in either deck. So I'm going to take that one there. Pack gets passed over. This is a very easy pick from this side. I've taken a first pick yellow Take Flight, and I know I passed a yellow Herald, and that was most likely the card they were probably going to take next. At least they, if they didn't, they would take the red shadow card, and then there were two other light cards. So kind of where I'm at is I want to be putting my next seat into Illusionist here, and this is the pack that sets this up perfectly. In fact, on top of that, if I take an Illusionist card here, then they've probably just taken a Herald, and even if not, the person after them has, which means that person or them will take this straight afterwards, and I'm immediately fighting for Prism, right? Whereas if I take this, I then put the next seat that I've already potentially put into Prism. If they take the Herald of Triumph out of here, then the next best pick might be this Wartime Herald, and they might be having to battle out. So I love the spot where I take an Express Lightning here and potentially pass two Prism cards and get some people battling over Prism. So from this seat, I'm definitely not wanting to be Prism in the future picks. Like, the one thing I want to note most importantly when I'm passing this pack is that if I switch, because I'm not married to Warrior yet, I've taken two Warrior cards, but I'm definitely not married two picks in. But if I'm going to change later on, Prism's the main thing I don't want to change to. So yep, third pick comes around. We've picked a Herald of Protection. So this is kind of an interesting draft because we're taking class specific cards. We're not staying super open, but we're also not married to them. So, but yeah, this pack comes around. There's two picks being taken out of this pack, and they're passing us high Prism cards. So we basically just want to take Herald and be Prism in this draft, or we'll be definitely looking to be Prism. None of these other cards stand out at me. I know that somebody else is going to take this Wartime in the next couple of picks most likely, so I am going to be fighting, but if I can commit reasonably early, I can possibly push them out. So I'm going to take the Herald of Triumph in that third pick. I'm going to hand this pack over to Aaron. I'm going to ask him to take two cards out of this one now. So this draft of hero is going to be on third pick, fourth pick, and fifth pick. I guess let's just put a card here for the unknown picks that they have taken earlier on, so that we know kind of what picks we're up to here. I'm putting Aaron on the spot here. He's really got to think and try to take the best two cards out of the pack. Maybe I should give him a little bit more time. So on the next one, I'll give him the pack straight away. But yeah, I think our spots are interesting. Maybe out of those two picks, since I gave Aaron a first pick and then two picks from this, maybe we'll pop those picks here. That could be interesting. Do you want to hand me the first pick? Yeah, I guess if it's high, yeah. All right, no, Aaron's informed me that doesn't really work because it would have changed how I'd make these picks. Yeah, I guess we just have to leave them at blank. It still gives us plenty to talk about anyway, and information here. Let's do it in a way that it works though, eh? All right, what do we got here? Okay, so again, let's just do the shadow cards here, the light cards over here, and the generic cards up here. So we got another warrior one here, a couple of light cards here, and this pack is kind of light on the shadow, which is good, because in this spot, we want to be passing all the light in the world. As many drafters after us that are all light together as possible, please. So interesting thing here. So we've got some powerful cards that we can make some decisions on whether to go. We're looking to be a shadow class most likely. We're not going to switch for any of these cards. They're not powerful enough and in a pack. I'll give Aaron the other pack now to start thinking over his three cards to remove on the next one. But yeah, I think none of these cards are powerful enough and signals enough for us to jump into a light class. We've been past some pretty powerful shadow cards anyway. So there's not enough signaling going on here because we're only three picks in, that we just want to kind of look to be getting the table to where we want. And passing a bunch of light cards is definitely where we want. So we're a Riftbind and a Lunatide Plunderer in. We're looking to be one of the two shadow classes. So here is an opportunity to take the only Runeblade out of the pack and pass the pack with no Runeblades, no Runeblade cards, which is great. Kind of, you know, push a signal that that the next people will see that there's a Runeblade drafter here and they probably want to stay out of it, and then put some other people into Brute, I guess, and a bunch of people into Light, which is exactly where we want to be. So this is really setting ourselves up to be one of the few Runeblade players at the table. From what we've passed so far, we haven't passed anything powerful in Runeblade yet, and we've passed a lot of light cards. So exactly where we kind of want to be in this pack. Okay, so next pick over, this is fourth pick for this person. So far we've got a Take Flight and Express Lightning. We're looking to ideally be Warrior. We know that we're passing into Thing. We're getting past a pack with no Runeblade cards. We know that there's most likely a Runeblade drafter to our left, either, you know, one or two or three people to our left. We're looking to pretty much, like, if we can take a good Warrior card out of here and not pass high Warrior signals, then we're looking to pretty much commit to Warrior. So the interesting spot here is that there's three light cards here. So it is scary that we're going to be potentially passing a few people into light and giving people down the line signals for light. So we got to be mindful of that. But we're also signaling some Brute as well. So mostly if we're Warrior, we're in an all right spot there. I think ultimately the most powerful card for Warrior is probably the Steel Hand. These cards keep us more open, but we're very unlikely to jump over to Prism in this situation, because just last pick we passed two very strong Prism cards, like a Herald of Triumph and a Herald of Wartime Herald. So we knew we were passing two people into Prism. So we're not looking to stay open and light. We're looking to pretty much just be Warrior. So I'm going to grab the Steel Hand. I rate it over the Yellow Battlefield Blitz. I think it's great pick. Gonna pass a bunch of stuff. So this one, we're onto this guy here. This is onto pick five. This is the pack we've been passed. So what the signals that we have, is that there's a Runeblade drafter somewhere. We're starting to get some good signals here that potentially light is kind of open. And that Brute is kind of open. So, we've got a couple of Illusionist picks so far. So we want to lean towards Illusionist, but it's looking like there's potential that Warrior's even kind of open as well, but also kind of not, because these are just yellows. They're not amazing. But from this pack, what I would be wanting to do is stay open to light in case Warrior's open, because we don't actually know that this is Warrior drafter here for fact. We're just assuming on some stuff. Rise Above is a great card, but generally what I'm going to want to do is cut a light card from this pack, because we're passing so much light that we don't want to be, you know, passing. We want to kind of cut down the number of signals. If I'm Illusionist, I much prefer Illuminate to Rising Solitide. It's close, but the fact that this with a blue can be a weapon attack and then followed by this, or in an Illusionist deck, I like to block quite a lot, so it can be kind of block with my whole hand, leave me with one card, and then I still get to attack. So I think Illuminate is a great pick there. And we'll pass it all along. So Aaron has removed three cards from this pack, and then he's going to hit on the next one. So again, same thing. Let's get the shadow cards over here. Oh, there's a lot of shadow cards. We are laughing over here with the amount of shadow cards. So this is interesting. This draft seat is ideal. Okay, so shadow is very much open. We have light drafters on this side. We have light drafters on this side. We are looking to make sure we don't pass very many shadow signals. And here, unfortunately, we are passing some shadow signals. Three reasonably strong shadow cards, but they're all brute. So this is the point where I'm three picks in. I have a really good signal to be shadow. I'm passing some strong brute signals, so I'm just gonna be Runeblade. Like, you know, here I'm pretty much gonna hard commit to Runeblade. And the most important thing I wanna do here is signal to people that I'm Runeblade. I want to make sure that I'm not passing too many Runeblade cards and putting too many people down the line I'm Runeblade. Like, my goal is to be, you know, the only Runeblade drafter or one of two Runeblade drafters. So even later on in the packs, if I leave a piercing shadow blade for somebody to take, it's going to be annoying for me. Seeping shadow, I don't rate very highly, so I don't think that's much of a signal. Piercing isn't that much either, but it is a Runeblade card, and I'd like Runeblade cards to kind of dry up. Like, if I take this and there's three Runeblade drafters at the table, the second one may end up taking this, and then the third one will go, okay, I need to switch out a Runeblade. So I think very important thing is to cut down the amount of Runeblade cards I'm passing. So more than happy to take a piercing shadow vice here and pass the rest of these cards along. So we're into fifth pick here. This is the part where we're going to get some signals and kind of figure out what we're doing. So we're reasonably committed into Warrior here. We definitely want to be Warrior, but in looking at this pack, we're quite worried about the number of light drafters probably on this table. The good thing is that there's no illusionist cards in the pack. So it's more likely that we might have two illusionist players passing to us than warrior players. We've got some great warrior cards. We really want to commit to warrior. I think the only thing we could really switch into here is brute with these signals. But I think that there's not enough of a signal that warrior is closed. If this card was an illusionist card, for example, even after taking Take Flight, Express Lightning, and Steel Hand, I would take a brute card here. If this was an illusionist card, I would be looking to potentially switch based on the next signals I get, and be switching into Runeblade. But since we've got a warrior card here, and it looks like it's more likely that there's illusionist players to our left, like there's definitely illusionist draft people that have drafted illusionist cards, and there's not definitely people that have drafted warrior. So I take this card here for sure, and pass it along. Now it gets interesting, real interesting. So this spot here, we've taken a couple of illusionist cards and we've taken a light card. And then on our sixth pick, where we get quite a lot of signals, there is no light cards and no illusionist cards, right? So we got two options. We can look to potentially still try to stay light and jump over to warrior if that becomes somewhat open, but we know we're gonna be back lane with at least a warrior player somewhere on our left here, and we're probably going to be back lane with an illusionist player as well. This is where I would look to jump. So even though we've taken a couple of prism cards, we have a very clear signal that light is not open, and that brute is very open. So here I would be looking to try to jump into brute. Now the issue with that is that somebody else will potentially jump into brute as well, because we're going to take one of these cards and we're going to leave the other one in the pack. So somebody else is going to do the same sort of thing. The good news is that player is going to be on our right, somebody that we're passing to, so we're still going to get two strong brute packs. We're six picks in, and we are pretty sure that there are no brute drafters within the three picks before us, the three seats before us, and that's exactly where I want to be. If there are three seats before me that don't have, that aren't in a particular class, I want to be in that class. So this is where I'm definitely going to take a brute card. So it depends what I want to pass, whether I want to pass convulsions or whether I want to pass dread screamer, and which one I think is more important for me. So I think a lot of people in this spot would be like, oh, you know, if there's no good cards for me, I guess I'll take the front line scout that works in here, or I'll take the equipment piece because it's a decent equipment piece. But I think that that's very wrong. I think you really need to jump on the opportunities that you have. And if brute is open, it's correct to just jump on brute, to be honest. So I would take a brute card here. I think these are very, very close in power level. I think I like to have a convulsions in my deck, so I'd like to take this earlier for a bit of a setup plan. I want to get as many dread screamers as I can get, but earlier on when I don't know exactly how my brute deck's probably going to look, I'd rather take one of these because I like to always have one. So I'm going to take the convulsions out of this pack and pass it along. Okay, so here we go, pack number five. Okay, so we get our generics over here. A lot more generics in this one. We've got some signals, I tell you that much. All right, so generics over here. We got plenty of signals that light drafters have been taking light cards. Yeah, in this seat, we are just laughing. We're a shadow drafter where we're playing Runeblade. It looks like there's not many shadow drafters to our left and that there's some serious light drafters to our left. We just got past a fifth pick stubby hammers, which in my opinion is one of the top equipments. So it's crazy that that's still in the pack as well. And we get to take it without passing really any Runeblade signals for light. So we are absolutely just laughing. We snap take the stubby hammers. Our deck looks amazing. We're going to have a very strong Runeblade draft and we're loving it. We're loving life. This pack gets passed over to here. We're sitting strong in a warrior seat here. This pack's a little bit concerning for the same reason as the last pack. So there's good and bad points to it. Good points is that we're not passing any warrior cards at all. So we're passing no warrior signals going that way, which is great for us to stay warrior. The bad thing is that there might be a warrior drafter on our left by the way these packs are coming out. So here I think Red Brandish is the best card in the pack. Rise Above's decent as well. And then Blue Take Flight after that. In this on pick six, I would rather take the Blue Take Flight even over the better Brandish card because I don't want to pass any warrior signals and I want to pass a signal that warrior has definitely been taken. So I want to get that Take Flight out of this pack. You know, Runeblade players will play Brandish, Brute players will play Brandish, Illusionist players play Brandish, so I'm not passing a huge signal here and I just get this out of the pack and make sure I don't pass any warrior signals because we're pretty committed. Over to this pick. So we took a convulsions after taking a few light cards. We got past this pack, which is interesting. So where we're kind of at is we've already passed a few good brute cards earlier on in the packs when we were taking these. So we're not, it's going to be hard to massively push people out of brute if people near to us took brute. So we're just relying on getting good brute packs, pack one and three, and not necessarily worrying about pushing the people that are past us out of brute. So we are wanting to take the more powerful cards and we're still potentially wanting to be a little bit open. But ultimately we're pretty sure we can't be prism because there's prism drafters. We're pretty sure we can't be warrior because there's warrior drafters. There's a potential for us to be Runeblade here, but we're six picks deep and likely haven't taken a Runeblade card yet. We took three prisms and went here. So we're ultimately probably trying to stay out of that. So we're pretty locked into brute. There's not really any other options. So if there were other options, I would snap take the Brandish or a Rise Above to still stay reasonably open. But ultimately where I'm sitting at in this seat, there's not any other options other than to be brute. So Endless Moor's pretty powerful card. The problem is it's not a six power, but it does attack for eight, which is huge. And then we've got Hunger and Shadow Beast that is a six power or a seven power even. So it's a great take. And then we've got a couple of generics. So I think this pick is quite difficult. This pick is quite interesting because for a few reasons. So we kind of want to take a brute card out of the pack so we're not passing too much brute, but we've also passed so much that we kind of don't care if people, you know, we kind of can't force people out of brute anyway. But on the second hand, if we take a brute card in the next, somebody in the next two picks, packs from us, picks down from us are brute, they'll take the other one and we'll kind of force anybody else out of brute. So that's a positive for it as well. So yeah, a lot of interesting information. But ultimately, Brandish is really good in brute anyway. It's go again. It's something I'm wanting to pick up. Like, I really like the brute decks that can kind of start off with a Brandish and then play one of the more powerful two cost cards after pitching a blue. I think that those are your kind of really good mid game turns. That's quite how I like to play brute anyway. So I kind of want to favor the Brandish here, and it's a little bit annoying that I'm passing two brute cards. But as I say, I've already passed so much good brute stuff that we're on the strategy of just getting good pack one and three for brute, and we might have to give up a bit from pack two and probably still end up with a great deck, because we're very, very certain that there's not many brute drafters coming on the left of us for quite a few people, but based on what we keep getting past. So I think I'm happy to take Brandish here. I think it's a great card, and I'm gonna hopefully look to keep getting past good brute cards. So yeah, this looks a little bit messy. Like, for this pick, drafter number three, it looks like their draft's a train wreck, but honestly, it really isn't. I think they just got themselves into a good spot, identified where they should be, and now they're set up well to have a decent brute draft. Yep, they're going to have to abound in a few picks, but I think ultimately they're going to have a great draft. And we already know now that we have all this information, we know that that these guys aren't brutes. So they're in a good position. So now what it might be good to look at, Aaron's sorted the other kind of seats of what he picked out of the packs, which is kind of interesting. So we can sort of see what this seat has done for, you know, four picks at least. So here's what's quite interesting. So I think this seat first picked a Via Vanguard, second picked a Take Flight, third picked a blue Take Flight, and fourth picked an Express Lightning. So we got a seat here that's firmly in Warrior as well. So we got our two Warrior drafters very close. It'd be interesting to see how this would happen later on. But yeah, we were very certain in the seat that the drafter to our left was a light class based on what was being passed around. So definitely we're going to get rewarded here for being Shadow. And then we're thinking it's most likely another light as well from this as well. So pass me the Illusionist drafter. Haha, how did I know it? So over here we got, obviously, these are where all the early Illusionist cards that we were missing in these later packs were taken from. They were all grabbed over here. So we're getting a little bit of information here. The rest of the information is not going to be much, but let's see it anyway. A couple of picks from over here. Oh baby, we got a Cold Foil Galaxy Black. Hey, that's a cool little thing to open. Yeah. Oh, fab with Matt, Cold Foil Galaxy Black. So so we definitely rare draft over here, because like, why wouldn't we, unless we were in the top eight of a calling? We're pretty much always going to take that Galaxy Black. In top eight of calling, we're going to have to pass it. It is what it is. You're playing for a lot more money, but outside of that, grab that Cold Foil Galaxy Black and be very happy to open it. And then the first pick from the very first pack. Yeah. Yeah. Or the last pack, I guess, was a seed. So interesting spot here. But yeah, we don't know too much about what these drafters are going to be in. But this drafter is in a fantastic seat, knowing that there were two light drafters to their left. They were passing a decent amount of brute cards, but also a lot of illusionist cards and warrior and like decent warrior cards. So we were passing a bunch of light. Even though we knew we were having light drafters to our left as well, so we're in a well situated spot here. This one here, we were reasonably sure there was a Runeblade drafter to our left from some of these later picks, and that we were passing a lot of brute cards and a lot of illusionist cards. So we were pretty happy to be warrior in this seat. It's going to end up quite interesting with the battle between these two warriors here. So if there ends up being more warriors down here, we could have a hard time in this seat. But the good thing about this seat is we passed almost nothing warrior. We passed so few warrior cards that we're likely not fighting with any warriors that way. We're just going to be fighting with the one this way. So this seat here, well set up to be brute. Draft doesn't look great because we had to abandon so many picks, but honestly, this seat is going to be great. We're in a situation where the four drafters passing to us are not in brute, and we're going to get a lot of good brute cards. So packs 1 and 3 are going to be fantastic, and I think it's very likely that this seat will end up with a very strong draft deck, even after having to abandon so many picks. So yeah, hope that was insightful, and we'll head back to the couches, eh?
All right. Well, that was interesting. That was good.
Yeah. I'll tell you what, I've got to talk about it right off the bat. There's nothing like cracking first edition products, and then you hit the cold
portal. And you hit the cold portal Galaxy Black.
Even though... Guys, they were max packs.
Yes!
He decided to crack a first aid box to use the packs on the video for the potential, and we got this, so it was awesome.
Well, that actually wasn't a box. Those were the packs that I got from the Mighty Ape event. So I got top 4 in the Mighty Ape event. I got a few packs. I left them on my desk for a rainy day, and boom, we got them.
Yeah,
Galaxy Black.
So good. Obviously, as Matt said, in a calling, you're probably not taking a weapon you could use as a token.
No. And a calling top 8, you're not going to take the Galaxy Black.
But in any other situation, I'm taking that ultimate.
And a calling in the Swiss, if you're like 9-0 or something, do you take it?
If I'm 9-0, I'm taking it.
Yeah, you're like, I'm almost certainly making top 8 anyway. Yeah. Slam some value.
If I've gone X1 and I'm in the second draft, I'm still not taking it, I think
only scenario where I take it at a call-in is, basically if I'm 9-0.
Yeah, I mean...
Going into the second draft or 10-0 or whatever it is, going into the second draft.
Yeah, we talked about it, obviously, there was a lot of knowledge getting thrown out there, and there was no need to ruin that and those packs with, like, you know, putting you or the person to your right or left in the spot to take the...
To just take it
for. It didn't make any sense. So, yeah, we red drafted and we got there. Yeah, the packs were
super. I think outside of a core line, you're just always taking Galaxy Black, right? So like, it's, you know, it's pretty representative, you know, a good representation of what would have actually happened.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, but the packs were super interesting.
Yeah, so I mean, in a set where you want to stay open, you know, everybody talks about how important it is to stay open. You'll notice we pick fast cards a lot. I think, you know, I agree you want to stay open. But by that, I just mean I don't want to marry picks. You know what I mean? Like, yeah. I'm happy to take class cards first pick, second pick, doesn't matter. As long as I'm more than happy to give them up if I'm in the wrong seat for them.
Yeah, so the perfect example, obviously, was that far right drafter that you were taking.
Yeah, that was a great, interesting spot, to be honest. Take three, couple of prism cards and a light card, get to 6 picks in and switch over to brute. And crazy enough, I think that seat is fantastic. I think that seat is going to end up with a very strong draft because you are well signaled into brute. Even a couple of picks before that, even when you were taking those prism cards, you were getting past good brute cards in that seat.
Yeah.
So I think your position there, now that you're brute, when you've passed, when you know that there's light drafters on your left, you know there's a Runeblade drafter on your left, we know that from the packs, right? I think we're in a great position to be brute there and just have a really strong, the rest of pack one with, you know, and then an incredible pack three.
Yeah, it's easy to look at your first seven picks, I think it ended up being, but and be like, oh no, where am I going?
Yeah.
You're not even halfway through the draft yet.
Yeah, exactly.
At that point.
I mean, a lot of people would look at that and be like, what? You got illusionist cards, a light card, and then a brute card and stuff. What a train wreck.
Yeah.
I think that seat's going to be fantastic.
Yeah, and I do think you touched on it, basically everything in detail in the video. But
yeah.
Especially that Brandish pick, that's a card which has, the red one specifically, has gone way up in my like brute draft guide, like from when we first
started drafting. Yeah, Brandish is just
something
a good
I was passing,
card.
Right? I would take
really
looking at Dread Screamers, like more brute specific.
Brute really likes go again cards.
Yeah.
So where it's not an amazing Brandish deck because it doesn't like care that much about the weapon attack, it doesn't really have ways to pump Brandish so that you can hit through to get that trigger.
Yeah.
But what Brute really, really likes is go again attacks. It makes your mid game much stronger. And Brute's looking for a strong mid game so that then, because Brute really wants to block in the early game, fill up its graveyard, and then have a reasonably strong mid game so that it can pivot and turn thing and, you know, turn some pressure around and then so that it can kind of effectively combo the end game, right?
Yeah.
Like,
okay, so I guess the question I would have, and I'm assuming some of the viewers will as well, is how far do you go with that? Brandish, like I said, you're not really looking for that plus one to get through, but it is a format where there's a ton of block twos. There is potential for hit, and you do still have the axe. So there is flexibility on a bad turn. Like, that's fine if you can get the pump, the plus one, potentially come in for six with the axe if the Brandish is hit. But
all
if you
off
want
blue
go
as
again,
well.
Yeah.
All off a of blue. All so Brandish blue. Plus axe attack
so
is all off a of blue.
It's a two card.
Yeah.
Great turn. But you said you want go against. Are you happy with Red Belittle? Are you looking at that in the
same
way?
It's the exact same card.
Okay.
But sometimes you can pick up a blue Minnowism at some point, and like that Belittle doesn't have very many three power things to show. But if you picked up a red Belittle early and you're brute, you can prioritize taking blues that have three or less power if you had a Minnowism. So basically you take the Belittle, right? If you manage to get a blue Minnowism early, you just prioritize blues with low power, and then you might be able to just get a spot where you play, Belittle, reveal one of your blues, search another blue, and then you've got two blues to do some like crazy turn.
Yeah,
you know,
which is what the brute deck wants. Like, it can be resource heavy when you're going for the big turns.
Yeah, definitely, right? Definitely.
Yeah. I mean, you know, there's been a lot. I think LSS themselves have put out some great videos with the pack one, pick one. Which I think everybody got behind. And I found it really interesting. There was a lot of talk about staying open and all of this sort of stuff. I opened the first pack. I see V for the Vanguard.
Slam that card.
I'm looking at it, I'm like, oh, there's some other good cards I could stay open.
Am I supposed to stay open?
Am I supposed to stay open? But that card is
exceptional.
It's
that card insane. Is very, very good.
Yeah.
Like, I kind of disagree with the notion of like, you know, high pick generics and everything and try to stay as open as you can. Like, I disagree that as with that as a hard rule. I like to stay open. You know, I like to be able to get myself into a spot where seventh or eighth pick, I realize that like the four people passing to me aren't in a certain class and I just jump in. I love to be able to be in that spot. But you can be in that spot by still taking powerful class cards in the first few picks.
Yes, sure.
You just have to abandon them. And you know, the thing is, you get to pick 45 cards and you only play 30 or, you know, a few more of that. You can absolutely afford to abandon some picks.
Yeah.
And I think that's the thing that too many people are scared of, is abandoning picks.
Yes. Yeah. Well, I like how I think it's a different way of looking at it. I like how you described it, where staying open isn't necessarily just taking generics.
Yeah.
It's being willing to let go of your first three, four picks if something else becomes open.
Yeah.
Right?
Drafting is really very much not about opening powerful cards, but about figuring out what you should be in. You know, in your given seat, what is open? What are the people, you know, kind of three or four people passing to you? What class are they passing along? What are they not in?
Mm.
You know, that's really what you want to figure out in a draft. It's not really about, you know, first packing via the vanguards and super powerful cards or whatever. It's not about getting that draft.
I mean, it can help.
But draft and flesh and blood is much more about your positioning in the table and how you can kind of control and somewhat manipulate the table around you as well. You, it's way more important in this game to be aware of the things that you've passed, the signals that you've given, the things that have clearly been taken and stuff. Like, we were identifying that in each seat, you know?
Well, it's super interesting, and we've talked about it a little bit and touched on it in other videos very briefly, but Monarch brought a whole nother element with draft, which was well represented in, you know, the picks that we just did.
Yeah.
And that was the fact that there's class cards, right? You can take a light card and it still keeps you open, and that adds such a deep element to draft that wasn't there in WTR and ARC.
Yeah, great.
Right? It was generic and you had your class cards. And this is like this other pool that you can go into where you get to take something a little bit more powerful, potentially, still stay open, have that flexibility, another level to reading signals of what's being passed. Yeah. Like a ton of
Monarch is so well designed. They did so well with Monarch. Yeah, honestly, I'm gonna be straight up here. I think Arcane Rising, a little bit of a failure. I don't think that was a fantastic I don't think they hit the nail perfectly on the head on design for that set for limited play.
Yeah, that's important to say when we're talking about draft specifically.
I mean, classic. Yeah. Obviously, Dash is really good. And Rubeload is really bad.
That's the set that gave us Azalea.
Yeah. I don't think they hit. They did so well with Wealth in a Wraith. You know, so incredibly well with Welcome to Wraith, and then Arcane Rising just wasn't on that same level. And that kind of started to worry me. And then they released Monarch, and it was way better than Welcome to Wraith. It was like, Monarch is just an incredible draft format. Yeah. They did so well.
I mean, I agree with you. Let's put it out there. I do have to say, I did, and I think Fav specifically as a card game that I've played that brings a whole nother level of enjoyment in draft, where despite me agreeing with you with WTR compared to ARC, you know, Monarch compared to ARC, there was still I still had a level of enjoyment drafting ARC because some of my favorite heroes,
not the best heroes.
But some of my favorite heroes were in that set. And so I think that's great, right? Like, I wouldn't be stoked about sitting down and drafting plus doing Sealed of Ark at a calling.
Yeah.
Right?
When somebody just might open
it. If I'm doing a casual 8-man draft, I'm there to have fun.
That's fair.
Then I'm still perfectly fine looking at it. But obviously, the walkthrough just did very angled towards competitive, like picking, reading signals, doing that. Monarch just
It's also Arcane Rising is kind of a bit of fun.
Yeah.
I think that's fair. It is kind of a fun set to muck around with. I just didn't really like Arcane Rising that much because Induction Chamber power level was just through the roof. And the signaling and kind of the committing to things like the in-draft strategy just wasn't at the same level as it was in Welcome to Wraith, and then not even close to how it is in Monarch. From a strategic draft competitive player standpoint, Arcane Rising is kind of a, you know, 5 or 6 out of 10. Welcome to Wraith is an 8 and Monarch is a 12.
You know, we've already heard some rumors about Kingdoms, and James is on the record saying, like, it is the best.
Yeah, he's just out of stream, right? I can't wait. I'm looking forward to that then. Yeah. I mean, if you've really made a draft format that's better than Monarch, wow.
Yeah,
like, that's really good. I think, what am I going to do with my life? I'm just going to play Fab. It's too much fun. Yeah. What else do you want to do?
But, I mean, hopefully that little walkthrough of Matt helped. I know I was there and I was actually worried I was going to screw the thing up with my picks at the beginning. I was like, oh no. But then, you know, Beaver the Vanguard, Old Dark Galaxy Black, what can you do?
It drafted itself.
Another thing, going back to the picks and the Monarch draft we just did as well quickly, I love how your seat, as I would take it, the first pick you were doing, it almost felt like we were revisiting your calling deck.
We're on our way to it, eh? That was going to be a good room play deck.
Building up pretty well, considering there was no one really to your right. And the way the packs went up, I think the very last pack, so four seats down, first pick the red seeds, but obviously we wouldn't know how the rest of that
would play out. They may not, you know, they're not going to marry that seeds. It's just one pick. So
yeah, exactly.
They might be room blade, they might not. It's, you know, depends how things fly. But like the great spot is that seat wasn't really passing any room blade signals either. Like it managed to grab the one good room blade card out of each pack. It was kind of great.
Yeah.
It passed one decent one and the red card on the first pick, I think. Or first or second pick, that shadow card that is much better in Rune Blade than it is in Brute. So that was one signal, but that one is not a big signal. It's not a powerful card, and it's probably not going to be picked for a few picks anyway. Yeah.
There was one pick that I think it was maybe the most uncertain I was. I've really enjoyed playing with it, and it's felt very, very powerful. But I think it was the seat to the right, the guy that picks the seeds, the Old Art Galaxy Black drafter.
The Galaxy Black.
Where the second pick, I believe it's Red Consuming Aftermath.
Yeah, Aftermath.
So it's a shadow card. It's obviously six power.
Yeah.
It's great versus illusion. It does cost three.
Yeah.
But that ability in both Brute
as a finisher
and Rune Blade as well, with the advantage of being able to banish a shadow, which you can potentially play.
Yeah.
What's your thoughts on that? Like, that's
very powerful card.
Super powerful.
Yeah. Definitely a high pick. I picked that card in the first few picks of the draft. I think it was correct for you to pick it in that seat. I definitely never unhappy to have that card in my shadow deck. No matter what my shadow deck is.
That's cool. It's an interesting one.
It's great in Brute because it you banish a six power and it turns off Blood Debt.
Yeah.
It's great in Rune Blade because you know it banishes something that you're then going to play, you know, either that turn or next. It's a fantastic finisher in the late game because it's dominate.
And even in something like Brute, it has play where when you have something like that, you want things like Howl from Beyond and stuff anyway.
Yeah.
So that added value, and like different things seems really, really good. But yeah.
Very high pick cut shadow card.
Yeah. But I guess.
And an illusionist, it blows up illusions.
Yeah. I think, you know, and we've been talking more specifically about draft today.
Yeah.
But I think there has been a lot of talk about illusionist in this format as well. More specifically sealed, but I felt like early on in the format, a lot of people translated that sealed play to,
just take illusionist cards because it's so powerful.
Yeah, but that hasn't been my, in draft has felt like a completely different format almost. Like
it is a very different format to sealed, and illusionist is kind of just on par with the rest. Like the four heroes are very evenly weighted with how good they are.
Yeah.
I've said it many times. I have zero preference.
Yeah. Well, even so, in the top eight of the calling.
Yeah.
I believe yourself and Kiki were the only shadow drafters.
Yeah.
Drafters, and then there was.
We had a whole table of shadow cards coming around. Kiki got my seconds most of the time.
And it was. Three prisms. Was it three prisms?
No, it was four prism, two Bolton, one chain, and one Levia.
Yeah.
So
I guess
four people battling over prism. Oh, what a mess.
I mean, so we've obviously, you know, people have seen the packs. We cracked open. We went through quite a few today. I think it was five packs. To me, it didn't feel heavily weighted there. What do you think, like, is illusionist, is that just an onset of people maybe rating some of the illusionist cards higher than maybe they should have been?
Yeah.
Obviously, some of the Red Heralds are fantastic.
Yeah.
But
I think people mostly overrate Prism, yeah. I think people get past some Red Herald and think, well, Prism's open. Some common after other people have taken, potentially another Prism common and a Prism rare and stuff. Like a lot of, there's not very many not good Prism cards. Most of the cards are good. Yeah. But I think people rate those cards as great because they have seven in the power box. They're all so big, so everybody thinks they're so good. But it's quite, it can be quite a give in momentum and tempo. If you play a Phantasm card and they get to block it with one card and take no damage for the turn, can be quite a big tempo shift. But I think people don't see that as much.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, you went super in depth during the breakdown. Anyway, it's a super interesting format, super fun. I think it's well balanced. I've loved drafting this set. I know you've obviously loved drafting
this set. Yeah, I love drafting this set.
Drafting this set's done pretty well for you. So
it's kind of the most fun I've had playing this game as well.
Yeah.
Things just seem to keep getting more fun with that. It's great. Can't ask for more than that.
Yeah. And I think obviously, as everyone out there will know, there's been a lot of hype and build up around the move to Classic Constructed with all the
which will be cool.
Road to Nationals.
Our next fab with Matt, we'll have to go over another Classic Constructed deck. I think people quite like the chain one last time. So next time we'll go one of the other heroes. Maybe whatever I'm probably planning to play at the first Road to Nationals. I might just give it away. I mean, I always said I would. With Fab with Matt, the people that tune in and watch this and stuff, that's kind of the advantage they get, I'm happy to give it away.
So next up, Classic Constructed, but there is plenty more drafts to be had with Monarch. Yeah. So hopefully for all you guys out there, that breakdown was helpful. Some of the chat about some of the cards. I think
there's still some questions as well. Yeah. If you have them, feel free to ask any questions about the spot. I might have missed something. There might have been something where you really disagree with my draft picks or my analysis. And I'm more than happy to go in depth. I love it. I love talking about that. So feel free to hit some questions.
Pop down any of the questions down in the link below. You may be seeing this on Facebook, in which case you can put it in the comments. If not, on the Channel Fireball
YouTube there.
Channel, pop them down. Matt will jump on and give you the correct answer, and I might troll a little bit with some thoughts that I want to offer. Otherwise, if you have anything else that you want to ask as well for Classic Constructed related as well, before our next video, make sure you get those on there so we have an opportunity to have them
to cover them.
And we can cover them as well. So there's going to be exciting things moving forward with the announcement of everything that LSS have lined up.
It's going to be some cool announcements in this next month with a lot of things, I think. I'm not so much talking LSS, but who knows? I'm going to leave it there, right?
National champion calling champion has some inside knowledge,
it's not inside knowledge. It's not LSS related. It's Fab related, but it's not. I don't get anything from LSS. I don't get any, anything like that. We might be talking about it on the next Fab with Matt.
Yeah. Okay. Cool. Awesome. Thanks, you guys, for tuning in. We look forward to next time. Hopefully this was helpful. Get drafting some Monarch.
Cool.
See you guys. Catch you guys.